late.
Howdy, partners. Welcome to the Haunted Chronicles, episode 168. Lay them straight. We have a real humdinger of a show for you tonight. Our friend Catherine Hayes joins us, and she flew all the way in from Australia to be with us tonight and is in the Haunted Chronicles green room drawing small woodland creatures on our Etch-A-Sketch. And this episode is brought to you, in part, by Etch-A-Sketch. You know, for more than 50 years, children and adults alike have been discovering the magical world of creativity with the classic Etch-A-Sketch. The iconic red frame, white knobs, and classic magic screen, and the shake to erase feature, not to mention the endless hours of fun it provides, have made it popular all around the world. Sketch, erase, and sketch again with Etch-A-Sketch by Ohio Art. I am Mr. Haunted. Jennifer Jigglypuff Runyon is searching for the elusive Yeti tonight, and it'll not be with us, but we have Heather, I'm so excited and I just can't hide it, Wade, host of Midnight in the Desert, which airs midnight to 4 a.m. Eastern time, and you could find that by going on to midnightinthedesert.com. Heather?
Good morning, Jimmy. You crack me up, man. You're awesome. You're really coming up. Etch-A-Sketch, huh?
Yeah, I made a couple phone calls to Ohio Art this week, and they hopped on board. They were eager.
That is really, really nice. That is really, really nice. I gotta say, I'm a big fan of the Etch-A-Sketch. Have been since I was a little tiny kid.
You know, every time I got an Etch-A-Sketch, like every year you get a new one for Christmas, and I could draw a square. and that was all I could do.
Right? I would try to draw a little, like, you know, the bad robot that you see, you know, the logo bad robot?
Yeah.
I would draw little creatures like that. So every time I see the bad robot logo, it takes me right back to childhood.
Oh, I should have tried that. Maybe, you know what? They're going to send me one this week, so I'll try it on that.
All right. Well, we do have a very interesting guest for tonight, don't we, Jimmy?
You know what? And I want to add, we do have a great guest, and I just want to add that I'm happier than a purple-tufted Tunisian dwarf hamster enjoying his free, refreshing blue raspberry Slurpee while leaning against the 7-Eleven store window like he's freaking Abe Vigoda.
That's because you're a professional.
And you know, I made that up on 7-Eleven because I did get we got free Slurpees. And that was a treat.
Well, what do we got in news tonight, Mr. Haunted? You said something about breaking news.
Funny you should ask, because I'm going to post this for Chatters.
Yeah?
And I have breaking news! Well, have you seen...
I have braced for impact over here.
You know, we try to keep this a PG-13 show. have you seen this picture of the 2,000-year-old fella from Pompeii that's gone viral?
Oh, I saw a little tiny thumbnail of it and realized what it was by the headline and just moved on to other news.
Well, you're smarter than I am because I went in depth to research this. Apparently, during the eruption of Mount Vesuvius 2,000 years ago,
this
gentleman is forever frozen in time in an odd position. Now, with molten lava rushing towards him, and apparently it appears that he decided to lay back and have, I'm doing finger quotes, relations with himself. So, you know.
It's called making the most of your time, Jimmy.
Yeah, and you know what? I probably would have skipped by it too, but I saw some of the comments, and that's what made it worth.
The comments are the best part.
These people are geniuses.
In the internet age, the comments, being able to comment on news articles has got to be the most wonderful addition to our culture. Oh my God. The comments are always the best on paranormal articles, regular old news articles. This we should have had years and years ago. How did we live without this? So do tell, I'm dying. What are the comments on this very important breaking news story, Jimmy?
Well, these are my top four or five. Okay, this guy says, he held on to the very end, great man. They get better. He died holding his loved ones.
Oh my.
He never saw it coming.
We don't really know that for sure now, do we?
No.
That part's still a mystery.
It's pure speculation at this point, at this juncture. And I think this is the funniest one. He put, talk about fiddling while Rome burns.
Oh my God, I'm going to die. Oh, good Lord.
And that does it for breaking news. You know, we want to get a guest in here.
All right. Well, you do have to admire a man who does make the most of the time that he has.
He did. He was working on something there. No, Heather, first of all, I want to thank you for joining us. If I didn't say it, and can you tell our listeners how to listen to your show?
How in the world to listen to my show? Well, I think it's more important, Jimmy, for them to be listening to your show.
They are.
You brought it up. Midnightinthedesert.com. It's really easy, in fact. We have a listen live link right there at the top of the page. Easy to find for anybody. It's free to listen live 5 nights a week, 4 hours a night. The most unexpected, weird, unexplained radio you will find on the internet, aside from Paramania Radio, of course, and that's how that's done. Of course, if you want to help keep this kind of content on the air, you can subscribe to become a time traveler and have access to the wormhole so you can send me messages on the air. You can harass me. You can give me a hard time. You can add your comments, your questions, what have you, to the program by having access to the wormhole. But that is not a requirement. The only requirement we have is that you are a night owl.
And for all the people that keep asking me to do a 2-hour show, along with this 1-hour show you get, Heather will give you 20 hours of quality programming a week.
That's right. I'm giving that to you
as a gift. All right. Tonight's guest, among other things, is a medium, a psychic, a paranormal investigator who studied demonology, and as a nursing student, her first job was in a psychiatric ward. And I think the coolest thing ever is she's from Sydney, Australia. And if you remember, Sandy from Greece is from Sydney, Australia. So I'm very jealous. Catherine Hayes.
Hello.
Welcome
to the program, Catherine.
Hey, Dave. How are you?
Hey, I'm happier than a blue-breasted mountain tuffet or something.
Just sitting here with my exo sketch, and I must say, it's a little bit interesting right now. So can I keep drawing while I talk?
Yes, whatever makes you feel comfortable. And I like that little raccoon you drew up in the tree. It's maybe very, very cute.
Right. Very interesting indeed.
Yeah. Well, this is really interesting. So you started out as a nurse in a psychiatric ward.
That was my first placement, long time ago.
And was that before or after your interest in the unexplained?
I've always had that. I mean, I've always been seeing, you know, spirits, whatnot, since I was very small. I never knew really what they were until I got a bit older. So at the time it happened, I was told where I was going and I was like, you've got to be kidding me. That was my first placement. So anyway, I spent a year there, and there is definitely a link between demonology and mental illness. It's what you would call a masking agent, which you probably already know, and it can hide behind people with schizophrenia, bipolar disorder, so on and so forth. I have, I've seen two occasions of it that I remember clearly. One of them was probably only about 5 years ago. I was no longer working in that place. I was only in a private practice as a, clinic nurse.
Mm-hmm.
But I've never forgotten this one. A young woman came in with a husband with PND, that's postnatal depression. And the doctor, who was a friend of mine, spent probably about 2 or 3 hours up in his office with her on the floor, huddled up in a ball, wouldn't talk. She was almost catatonic. And no one really knew what took her to that point, because in the morning she was fine and suddenly she was not so fine. And at one point I was called up there and the doctor said to me, would you just sit with her while we ring the hospital? Because she was having to be transported to the psych ward.
Mm-hmm.
So I sat in there with her for about 20 minutes with nothing happening, and I was trying to talk to her and, coax her out again. And at one point she turned to me and said, they're in the corner, I can't look at them.
Oh, no.
And I'm like, it was just her and I, and I just sort of stopped for a minute, because that was the last thing on my mind at the time. I was, thinking in work mode, and I sort of froze and said, what is in the corner? And she said, they're looking at me. When they're not in me, they're looking at me.
Oh. And you were just a kid then.
No, this was only 5 years ago.
Oops!
This was way after the fact.
Keep up with us, Jimmy.
No, this was my second last job in medical, and that was only about 5 years ago. And I wondered about this woman for about a year after the fact, because I never knew what happened. I left shortly after that. But she was definitely saying, you see them too. And I was like, holy crap, okay, this is not what it seems to be. But I couldn't tell anyone because no one believed me.
Well, this is something I have always suspected, but never really knew if it was true or not. And you would be one of the people who would know, in fact, if this was true, that mental illness is sometimes disguised. And what's going on is something demonic, whereas we see it in our tangible reality as just a mental illness and nothing else.
It's the same with substance abuse and things like that. It's a masking agent. And you let the barriers down, they can easily slip in, if you will.
Well, how do you help somebody in a state like that? Were you ever able to help this girl?
No, but funny enough, I saw her a year later in my next job, because where I worked wasn't far from the old place. And I saw her name in the appointment book, and I thought, do I or don't I? But I wasn't very busy, so I thought, I'll just wander up the hall from the treatment room and I'll see if I can grab her between, leaving the doctor's office and go to the reception. And she remembered me and everything, and I sort of said, so how are you? And she said, yeah, I'm great, why? And I was like, okay, so are you feeling better? What's going on? She said, what are you talking about? She had no memory of it.
Oh, really?
She had no memory of it, so I was kind of like, all right, let's just leave it there. Have a nice life. I'm good to see you again. And we're back to my job. So that tells me that it was more than PND, for one thing.
Mm-hmm.
She did have history of depression, but nothing serious. She had, slight episodes of, depressive states. But otherwise, she never had a strong history of, irrational behavior or anything like that. And she'd never been catatonic before.
That, to me, is very strange and very worrisome. I don't know why, that just strikes me as something to be very concerned about, that she's catatonic, saying that they're in the corner, they're watching her, and then a year later, oh, it's all okay, we're fine, it's all okay.
Yeah.
That really deeply disturbs me, Catherine.
There was something about the place that I worked into, because it was on top of limestone, and it also had a well underneath it.
Mm.
And, water and limestone do attract paranormal activity.
Mm-hmm.
There was always something going on there. And I was talking to the receptionist after she had left that day. And he was telling me another lady about 2 years before I began working there also turned up with PND. And she left feeling okay. She wasn't taken to the hospital or anything like that. She went home. But on the way home, she jumped in front of a train.
Oh, good. You know,
so there's a history in that place of women with PND coming in and, you know, obviously it's more than PND, let me say.
Well, I mean, this makes me wonder, then what other, disorders can be the demonic, but we think they're just mental disorders. I mean, how many disguises are there for the demonic?
Well, yeah, there's schizophrenia, obviously, bipolar disorder, also epilepsy, if you recall Anneliese Mickel case in 1976 in Germany. They kept saying that she was epileptic, but strong evidence proves that she wasn't. The medications didn't work. For one thing, if she had epilepsy, the medications would have worked. So, having listened to all her, the entire exorcisms of her, which went on for hours and hours, she clearly was not epileptic. But of course, people in medical don't want to actually believe that. And that was the problem with this girl that I was talking about. The doctor I knew is a good friend, and if I told him such as that, he would probably smirk at me and say, yeah, right. I mean, he knew I was kind of, you know, quirky because I'd mentioned various things I saw around the place. And he always just said, I believe that you believe it and leave it at that. So I couldn't really tell him what happened when she left. It's just something I had to, you know, deal with myself.
That's got to put you in quite a difficult position.
It was difficult, yeah, especially when you know that you can't really do anything, you know. The worst thing.
Well, you said that you see things, things around the place, and I know that you're a psychic medium as well. If you're involved with the demonic in this way, has the demonic ever gone after you?
No. I'm protected.
Really?
I'm pretty safe. We've actually, my husband's just walked in the door and he's putting his hand up here, so I think he has a story, if he can interject.
Hey, Scott.
Yeah, hello?
Put him on.
Yeah, put him on.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
We read you, Houston.
Welcome to the Haunted Chronicles.
Thank you very much. I actually suffered from a demonic attack when I was young and messing around with Ouija boards, but at the time, I didn't realize it was a demonic attack. It was only through later education, further down the track, that I realized that was what it was. I was about 12 years old at the time.
Oh,
and it was the classic example of it disguising itself as a young boy and starting off with the sympathy angle of I was murdered when I was four. And because we were all young kids and we had no experience in it, we took it at that, and it was a fascination thing.
Yeah.
And it gradually built up over a couple of days to the point where I was extremely nauseous. I was getting headaches, I couldn't hold food down, and at times I actually felt my spirit drifting in and out of my body. So it was pretty terrifying for a 12-year-old boy with no experience in that.
Did you ever actually feel a moment where it seemed you weren't you anymore?
It never succeeded in completely pushing me right out, and I was, because that was the first time I'd experienced anything like that, and I didn't know what it was, more panic than anything else. I've had out-of-body experiences since, and since I've become more mature and trained, a bit more training, but there was nothing like that then. It was just feeling really sick and just the actual shock of physically feeling myself partially drifting out of my body.
Wow. And that's just the beginning of it, right?
Yeah, that was just the start. Yeah.
Wow. Wow, God, so it can come on in such a subtle way that you may think you just have a sour stomach or something like that, and then weeks go by, maybe months go by, and you can end up, trapped in a situation where you have to seek a kind of help that most people don't even know how to find out there.
Yeah, with me in that situation, it was just pure luck that we had a little bit of an idea. We didn't know it was a demon. And it took a couple of days, but it was finally sorted out, but not after a lot of great drama. We had the old smell of sulfur. We had other spirits appear.
Yeah.
We had the full-on Hollywood-style windows and doors being thrown open.
Wow.
Objects flying across the room as it got to its climax. It was really, really terrifying stuff.
Hey, Scott, were you playing by yourself or with another person?
No, there was six of us in the room, but there was only ever three or four of us on the board at any one time.
And did anybody else get affected?
No, it was just me that it wanted.
Okay.
It made it quite clear that it was just me that it wanted.
Wow.
Through talking. And my sister, like Catherine, I'm also psychic and attuned to that kind of thing. My sister also is, and she was one of the ones who was there at the time. And there was a third girl there who was quite attuned as well. And while the three of us were on the board, was when it was at its strongest.
Does the demonic go after people like you? Does the demonic go after those that they know have a heightened perception of the unseen?
From what I've learned since, and from what I understand, yes.
It can go both ways. They either can be repelled, or they can see it as a kind of trophy.
Because a challenge.
Yeah, exactly. But they also, what you were saying about the four-year-old boy, they tend to put on the visage of a young child to gain empathy. And once they've got that empathy, they have a way in.
And they can use that to further manipulate you. So you two, you have no doubt of the reality of the demonic in this world.
No doubt.
No, we've seen it and experienced it firsthand.
The last case that we did was probably, about 2 years ago. A friend of Scott's had issues at his mother's house. She had a house guest, a relative, a young woman with a baby. And he sent us this photograph one night of what looked like an entity escaping from the baby's room. And it was like, oh, shit, we can't just leave him like that. And when we got there, unfortunately, there was what looked like a cast of thousands with their family members there, all heckling, especially this girl's father, who was a skeptic, to put it politely. And we couldn't really get much done because he kept, interjecting with things. But the point is, this young woman had done something that she shouldn't have, and she thought it made her all powerful. It was actually an infestation on her, not the actual house. And eventually the homeowner had to tell her to move on because things were getting too hairy in the house, and there was issues there with her erratic behavior. So she had to leave, and she had to obviously take the baby. So that was the real concern with that one. And no one really knows what's ever happened to them. As far as we know, Scott's friend hasn't even seen her, and she's a relative. So that kind of aspect of it, when there's a child involved, is actually, scary bit. She didn't want to help this girl. I sort of caught her in the kitchen that day, and the way she looked at me was, don't you dare try to move us. Mm-hmm. I read that in her thoughts, and I'm thinking, holy shit, that's when we knew it wasn't in the house, it was her.
And at that point, I was going through the house separate, and I'd trapped the entity in a walk-in cupboard in the rear bedroom of the house. And it was really, really trying hard to get out. It was doing its best to make me ill. But I was well prepared at the time. And fortunately for us, it wasn't a very strong entity. And while we managed to push it out of the house for possibly a short time, the girl herself was real resentful. And
very resentful.
As Catherine said, she thought it made her powerful, but what it had actually done, she'd invited it in, it had started to take possession of her, and it was becoming gradually stronger.
I have a feeling it didn't bode very well, but I hope I'm wrong, Obviously, in that case, you want everything to work out, but often in demology, it doesn't. It just doesn't. And while I don't fear anything happening to myself, I'm actually protected, but others aren't.
Well, Mr. Haunted, you know what I'm thinking right now, right? I'm thinking of the perfectly possessed. This mother did not want to help her child and took off. We don't know what happened to them. We don't know where they are. And this little child was a baby at the time and is now growing up. Is this baby going to end up growing up perfectly possessed?
That's what I think too.
It didn't seem to be wanting to possess the child, though. It was harming the child.
This is what really is upsetting about the whole thing. The child was getting scratch marks on it and things like that. And you'd think as a parent, if you were in your rational mind, that you would do anything you could to protect that child. But this woman wasn't at all interested or concerned about that. So that tells me that she obviously wasn't herself.
What was she interested in? Power?
She wanted power. She always. I'm seeing that she felt always small in life, didn't have any control of her situation, did some drugs and things like that, and obviously that's also an inroad. But she enjoyed what she thought was the power, but what she didn't realize, and many don't realize, is they always want something in return. It's never a gift.
And a little bit more background to that. As Catherine said, she'd been messing with drugs and alcohol. She was living with a guy who was a bikie, and it hadn't gone well for her. They'd broken up. And this all started because she started messing with black magic and trying to come up with a revenge spell.
Yeah.
Oh, well, I know, Jimmy, there's a break coming up here soon, right? But when we come back, I think we should talk more about how the demonic is attracted into a person's life. I mean, we may be doing things that we don't even realize are drawing the demonic in. And we should know what those things are, I guess, is just a preventative measure.
Yeah.
But there could be innocent things we think we're doing that aren't really going to amount to much, and we could inadvertently be inviting in the demonic.
I also have one more story from another workplace when we come back to, which is another sign of the demonic.
Oh, good. You know what? Catherine, we'll hear about that on the other side of break. And I'm getting there's a ruckus going on in the chat room and in the fringers. They want their celebrity birthdays. We'll do them on the other side of this break. I'm Mr. Haunted, along with Heather Wade, talking to Catherine and Scott Hayes, and we'll be right back. Welcome back to the Haunted Chronicles, home of your guaranteed halftime shout-out for those of you in chat. So, thanks for coming, Anne Maria, Dr. Dave, Indy Duane, Marianne, Fellini, Candui, Tiffany, Mary, Dead Dude Chad, Jolie, Desi, Maggie Renee, Kara E., Nicholas, Heidi, Courtney, Cheryl, Tony, Frankie, and we got the Fringers listening today, Mary, Todd, Kimberly, Brian, Smog, John, Tina, Michael, Dennis, Todd, Cindy, Ann, and Jerry. And if I missed you, I'm sure you'll let me know. And Michael. And you know what? Folks, this just came across the wire. Do not accept a Facebook friend request from John Jacob Jingleheimer Schmidt. If you do this, his name will be your name too. So it just came through. And there was such a ruckus going on in the chat. People wanted their celebrity birthdays, and I could not interrupt those great stories about demons with celebrity birthdays. So we'll use them as a buffer and get back into the demon stories. How about that?
All right. That's a plan.
All right. We only got two of them, so let's get them out of the way. Donald Sutherland has a birthday next week. He was in The Hunger Games, American Haunting, 2004 Salem's Lot, Outbreak, and the original Invasion of the Body Snatchers. How old will Donald Sutherland be next week?
Ooh, I'm going to go out on a limb and say 85 or 86.
I think maybe, 74, I'm going to guess.
Is Scott there?
Yeah, mate, I'm just wrecking my little brain.
I'm thinking
about 83.
Oh, so close. He'll be 82 years old. He's a tough one. And they were tough this week, guys. Jared Padalecki, who was in 2009's Friday the 13th, House of Wax, and is Sam Winchester on the TV series Supernatural.
I never get these right, so I'll go first. 61.
Go lower, guys.
I don't even know who it is.
38.
I'd just say 32.
35. Okay, let's get these out of the way.
Our psychic. You're closer than I am.
I didn't know the guy.
Okay, after I interrupted a perfectly good demon story that you were going to tell us.
That's okay. We have time, don't we? So
yes, we have plenty.
So what? Which one? The new one or the one we're just talking about?
Well, you said you had another one that you wanted to tell us, and I have some questions for you after that, but I am all ears. I want to hear this, Kate.
This one was really freaked me out more than anything. That was my last medical job. I was working in a dermatology clinic, and I was leaving the office one day around 5. And I got downstairs, walked out the building, and there was this old woman there just standing outside the building. I thought nothing of it. You know, just someone waiting for someone outside, big deal. Anyway, so walking from my office up the hill to the bus stop is roughly about, say, 300 metres.
Okay.
It's not a steep hill, but it's you know, a steady incline, if you will. And I walked up, and this old lady who looked so frail, I got to the lights, pressed the button to cross. She was right behind me. How she got there, because she looked blind, for one thing. Her eyes were white. She had no walking stick, but she kept up with me.
Mm.
And at that point, I was thinking, what's going on? I mean, I had no idea. I've never seen her before around the place. I've never encountered her before. So anyway, I started to get a bit freaked out there. So I crossed the road, got to the bus stop, and she was nowhere to be seen. I stood there, looked around, gone. I thought, okay, well, I'm obviously imagining it. It's nothing. Anyway, so got in the bus, and suddenly she was right there at the window staring at me, at my window.
Oh, fabulous. That's what nightmares are made of.
As you do, and she was just right there at the window staring at me. And she started to scream at me.
Whoa, she's screaming.
Even better.
Calling me, witch, you know, because, well, I am, but how did she know that? Oh,
wow.
I mean, witch, over and over again. Looking around, it was peak hour at that time, and no one really seemed to react. They sort of glanced at her, but no one thought anything of it. I was obviously a bit freaked out. And I don't scare easily, but I was shaking a little bit because how she got there is what really disturbed me. She looked frail, looked like she was nearly 90 years old. Clearly visual issues because she had the wide eyes, like she either had cataracts or, you know, glaucoma, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
But she had no walking stick.
Somebody with the whites of their eyes chasing you and yelling witch at you.
Yeah, this honestly...
It's scary!
Happened. You don't make this shit up. You know?
You just can't make it up. So what did you end up doing? I imagine that the people on the bus, either they didn't hear it. Some people, when they're not ready for this kind of thing, they just don't perceive it happening around them. Or they realize, oh, this is probably a crazy person and I don't want to get involved.
It was something along the lines of all of that, but most people were glued to their phones or had earphones in, so everyone was in their own little world for the most part. But it was just freaking me out because I looked at the bus stop, she was gone. But suddenly I get in the bus, I sit down, look out the window, and there she is, right there at my window. Oh. And she was staring at me, but not with her eyes. It was honestly the most bizarre thing I've ever experienced.
Did you feel like she was looking right through you?
Yes. Yes, and I felt actually, when I thought about it later, that she was actually waiting for me.
And that, what do you do about a situation like that? Did you end up just taking your bus ride to your destination, or what ended up happening?
I just pulled out a second later, and I was on the way home, so there was nothing after that. It was over, but it was disturbing the fact that she kept up with me. I walk very fast, and she was keeping up with me the whole time. She was frail. She had, again, no walking stick, and she was right there behind me the whole time.
You know what? That reminds me of something once that happened to me, and I don't know. I haven't thought about this in so long. This seems almost 3 lifetimes ago. when I was in my 20s, I was deep in my practice, and I was actually initiated into my coven and in my regular studies. And I remember being home on a weekend because I had a regular full-time job. And there was a knock at the door. And I go to the door, and there's a young man at the door that I had never seen before. Never had seen before. He was just, he was in a dirty white tank top and jeans, and it was really hot out. So he kind of looked like he had been out for 2 or 3 days, like he hadn't showered. And he handed me a hand-carved knife. It was like carved out of wood, so it wasn't like it was sharp or anything. It was just a one single wood piece, but it had all these strange symbols carved all along the handle and all the way up the blade, and he didn't say anything when I opened the door. I said, well, who are you, and what are you doing here? You know, are you looking for somebody who used to live here, or what's going on? And he just handed me this thing, and my instinct automatically was to not accept it.
Yeah, definitely.
I just went, do not accept it. Just close the door. And that's what I did. I said, well, no, thank you. You know, whoever you're looking for is not here. And he didn't say anything. He was just trying to give me this thing that maybe he carved or somebody else carved. So I ended up saying, you know, I'm really sorry. And I closed the door. And I didn't go back to my seat. I just sort of stayed by the door to see what he would do. And he set it down on my welcome mat and just walked off. And for the longest time, I didn't know what to do with that there. I took it and ended up burying it by a creek as deep as I could dig.
Good idea.
I am so glad nobody came up to me and gave me anything after these stories.
That sounded a bit like the BEK phenomena when you were answering your door. It had that kind of feel to it, Heather.
Yeah, it did. It did. And when I, like I said, that was so many years ago. I think it was 1996 or so. And had never heard of black-eyed children. He didn't have black eyes. He didn't look supernatural. He looked a little dirty, for sure. But I didn't know who he was. I didn't know how he found my door.
Wow.
And it made me wonder, just hearing your account on the bus and remembering that from my past, what is it that attracts the demonic to people, Kate?
Well, it could be a number of things. It could be because you do have psychic ability of some sort, and it's like having a candle in the dark. They see it, and they're attracted to it. Mm-hmm. Also, as we touched on mental illness before, they, more than anyone else, tend to attract, you might say, demonic activity, infestation, oppression, etc., and other illnesses such as epilepsy. They're all masking agents. They're the ones they really want to go for because they're easy.
Mm.
Mediumships, they don't tend to be targeted much because most of these entities are afraid of such people, in my experience. I've never really had any fear of that myself because I feel fully protected. But it's the weak ones that they tend to focus on because it's such an easy mark.
Low-hanging fruit.
Definitely, definitely. And they're the ones who are least aware of it too, so that's another sign, obviously. The least aware you are is an easier target. So to be forewarned and to be aware is to be armed against it. And this is a frustrating thing when you try to educate people like we do on our paranormal page and they just laugh. And I'm thinking, we're trying to help you guys and tell you what's going on out there. It's not crackpot theory. It's real. And they just laugh it off. And this is the real problem.
Oh, it is a real problem. I just saw a headline not even maybe a day ago or 2 days ago that the new booming business in the UK is exorcisms.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
By whom? So, I mean,
if there's such a high demand by people, just by everyone. If that is in such high demand, we really need to ask ourselves why. We really need to ask ourselves, what are we doing? Is there anything we are doing to draw this in on us? What are some things that most of us do, common things most of us do, that we don't realize are drawing in a possible infestation or oppression?
Well, anyone who consumes alcohol or drugs at some point, you do open a door a crack with those substance abuse issues, or even just having an odd drink. If you're in a negative frame of mind and you're having a drink, you can very easily open that door wider.
Mm.
It's about keeping your thoughts in good order and protecting yourself with those positive thoughts. When you do that, you find you have a safety net around you, protection.
Mm-hmm.
Negativity, they tend to draw on you too. So, and they tend to be the ones who abuse substances like alcohol, drugs, etc. Mm-hmm. So, that kind of thing.
And then depression also in with that as well.
Yeah.
People who let themselves get into a very deep depression
state, yeah.
And they start to head towards a really dark place. Gee, that's just like putting grease on the tracks.
And the thing is, alcohol is a depressant anyway, so if you're feeling depressed or suffering from the condition of clinical depression, alcohol is not the answer because you're just going to feel worse.
And possibly draw in something that you'll have exactly. No idea of how to deal with.
Exactly, and all those negative emotions like bitterness, anger, frustration even, that can draw it in. It's a weakness. So you need to keep your thoughts in good order so you are protected.
Catherine, how can people find your you do readings and you give help. What are your websites that people could find you on?
Oh, my actual own business is poem.com. That's P-O-E with a letter number 3, M.com, which I have a business partner, Yvette Melendez. We work there together. She makes the crafting, I do the readings and so on. You can find me there. I also, my regular day job is at AbsoluteSoulSecrets.com. I'm there most days. So it's an online network where I do readings from as well.
Okay.
So I sort of have two gigs there with that one.
And you know what? I hope that this rings a bell with you. I wrote down pool table. Is there some story with a pool table? Yeah.
Oh, I can play pool very well, but other than that, I can't think of anything in particular. So much has happened in life that I'm sure it might come to me afterwards, but...
That was a conversation stopper. I'll find out later what that meant.
Yeah, I can play pool, but I don't know what it pertains to in regards to what we're discussing at the moment. Sorry,
mate. I have no idea.
No one go to the pool hall tonight. Let's just...
I used to work in one when I was about 16, and I learned how to play snooker and pool there. But other than that, yeah.
All right. And what about the Comet Inn?
The Comet Inn is a very interesting place. We've had a hard time getting back into it over the years. Something happened there when we were there. How many years ago would that be?
Going back about 8 years.
Yeah.
The hard thing with that place, it's privately owned, and the owners... have come to an agreement with the angry female spirit that's on the premises, and if they've got the slightest idea or inclination that you're some sort of ghost hunter or thrill seeker, they won't let you in.
Yeah, we've tried to contact them many times. This place is almost in the middle of nowhere in a place near Hartley Vale in the Blue Mountains of New South Wales, and the first time we went there, I got very sick, and she attacks couples normally. She doesn't like anyone to be happy because she was miserable herself in life. What I did notice at that point when I saw her was that she had killed her husband and she won't leave her house. It's a huge house. It's, well, obviously it's an inn, so it has to be relatively big. It was a homestead at the time when this took place in the 1880s, and she is one nasty spirit. And
she's very strong.
Very strong, and I often find sometimes with these particularly negative human spirits, they can eventually over time either attract demonic activity or somehow morph into a quasi-demonic being themselves.
Mm, that's what I was just thinking.
Yeah, it's definitely possible. I mean, shadow people even, same thing. Negative people in life, tragic deaths, trauma, that kind of thing. That's what turns them into these things, and they can also develop into something quasi-demonic. Over time, obviously, not right away. It takes a number of years.
I would imagine.
Catherine, there's a story about from 2004 from a guy who lived on an old country road across from a cemetery. Does that ring a bell?
That one was in my upcoming thesis for Black Eyed Children. And it's an account I read about, and I freaked because this guy was talking about doing his own homework as well. at the time when I was doing mine, and it was late in the evening, it was well after 3 a.m, and he lived across the road from this cemetery. And he remember thinking nothing of it, but these three old people wandered out of the cemetery at that hour. It was a man and two old ladies, obviously over 80 years of age. And two of them either side were supporting the second lady, and walking down the road. Either way on the road, there was no bends. It was just a clear road, straight up and down. And he thought it was a bit strange because what were they doing at the cemetery at that hour, at that age? But he thought, okay, well, they might have their own reasons for that. So he thought nothing of it. But he checked again a second later, and they were gone. Where did they go? Again, moving really fast. These octogenarians were lightning fast. 1 minute they were there, next minute they were gone.
Wow, that's a creepy story.
And that one stayed with me as well.
And Heather, you know what? Going back to your story, I had a question I forgot about. When that man left that wooden knife at your door, yeah, was there any vehicle around, or did he just appear out of nowhere?
No, there was no vehicle. No, he.
Oh, that's even creepier now.
He came from nowhere, and he went back into nowhere. I saw him physically walk away. So I just, what really boggled my mind is that he came to my door. Why my door? I don't know how he would know that I live there. I don't know how he would know that I would be interested in witchcraft. It's not like I didn't advertise it. I didn't tell people, hey, guess what, you guys? I'm studying witchcraft in here. No, I didn't make any outward signs of that. I had a normal day job. I dressed like a business person. It wasn't obvious. So it really disturbed me that he came to my door.
Could have been a spiritual signpost on the other side.
Possibly. Now, that I won't rule out, but again, I never saw him in town. I went around, and I would walk to run my errands and such, and I never saw him in town, never saw him after that.
See, this is the thing, you know, with these people. They tend to just disappear.
Yeah, he came just clean out of nowhere, and I left that knife. It was kind of a dagger-type knife. I just left it on the welcome mat there for several hours before I even knew what to do with it. I was afraid to touch the thing.
Yeah.
And even when I did, I took an old dirty, you know, towel that I was using to clean the windows with, and I just wrapped it in that and took it over down to the creek as far away from my house as possible and just buried it.
Yeah, some that or a crossroads, either or, just get rid of it.
Mm, yeah.
We only have seconds left. This is so sad.
Yeah. What's going on? It's gone so fast.
That's a shame because I had another story about a human spirit that I moved out of a factory that was disguising itself as a demon spirit and had others that it was holding captive and using for energy.
You know what?
Oh, my God.
We're going to have a ghost call-in story show in October probably, and please call in with that story.
Yeah, will do, mate. Will do.
All right.
Oh, you need to have them back, Jimmy. You've got to have these two back.
And thank you, Heather, Scott, and Catherine, for joining us tonight. Midnightinthedesert.com to listen to Heather tonight. Thank you all for joining us. We'll see you next week.
It was a hoot. An absolute hoot.
Thanks, Jimmy and Heather.
It was a hoot.
It sure was. The best in paranormal radio right here on the Haunted Chronicles.